One of the most notable among Yoshihiro Togashi's myriad of strengths as a storyteller is his ability to craft charismatic and enticing villains. Of the four primary antagonists in Hunter x Hunter, and note that the term antagonist is being used loosely here, I consider three of them to be among the most well-constructed characters in the series. And this isn't even factoring in characters like the Royal Guards, Illumi, the Phantom Troop, and Periston. To put a personal spin on this, I can pretty confidently say that four out of my top five Hunter x Hunter characters could be classified as antagonists. These villains play a significant structural role in the arcs, and they're approached in ways that make them more multidimensional than the classic shonen villain. But most importantly of all, they're extremely well characterized. They were one of my favorite elements in Hunter x Hunter, so when transitioning into watching Yu Yu Hakusho, I was really interested to see what type of antagonists Togashi had developed in his earlier work. To take a step back for a second, Yu Yu Hakusho stands out to me because of its characters. It has one of the most well-realized and diverse casts I've ever seen, and for me, they were the major factor that elevated Yu Yu Hakusho from standard shonen fare to something greater. Nearly every semi-primary character was likable and memorable, and the interactions between them were always entertaining. But aside from the main cast of protagonists, I found myself just as impressed, or even more so, with the story's most iconic villain, younger Toguro. He was a deep adversary that slowly but surely became humanized as the Dark Tournament progressed, identifying with themes that were integrated with the story. But while this is impressive, what fascinated me most about Toguro was how the story slowly peeled back the layers of his psyche and reconstructed the audience's perception of the character as we went along. For me, Toguro is the most layered and intricately developed character in Yu Yu Hakusho. While it would seem like Sensui was a prototype for characters in Hunter x Hunter like Krollo and Meruem in some ways, Toguro is a villain whose characterization is entirely unique in comparison to any other character that Togashi has written. It is true that Toguro was to Yusuke what Hisoka was to Gon in terms of being an end goal with regards to power, and he has some similarities to Netero when it comes to some life endeavors, but everything else about Toguro distinguishes the man and makes him truly stand out. In essence, Toguro is built on dizzying layer upon layer, but he can be summed up using themes of grief, guilt, acceptance, loneliness, and atonement, which we'll get into a bit later. His motivations revolve entirely around a twisted, tragic, and initially unknown past, and only through the deliberate revelations that begin rearing their head throughout the Dark Tournament arc do we finally get a sense of just who this man is. Due to these reasons, I think that the best way of examining Toguro is by first looking at his actions and then inspecting the true feelings and motives behind these behaviors. Here we're going to look at his character journey, but include a vital piece of the puzzle that the audience doesn't have the first time in the anime: the context and ramifications of his backstory. About 50 years prior to the events of Yu Yu Hakusho, Toguro was head of a dojo along with his brother and a younger Genkai. The dojo had many students and everything was going well, until a demon named Kairin infiltrated the dojo and murdered Toguro's students, while also forcing him to enter the Dark Tournament as a guest. Toguro then went missing for 3 months, but showed up the day before the tournament with a team that included Genkai and his brother. His team encountered Kairin's team in the final, and Toguro took it upon himself to end the life of his student's murderer. But by this point, his mind was far gone. In his ever-present devastation due to the grief of losing his family and the blame he put on himself for it, Toguro asked that he be turned into an invincible, non-aging demon as reward for winning the tournament, and his brother followed suit. Genkai, who was sickened by Toguro's twisted desires, left and never intended to take part in the Dark Tournament again. Toguro had become twisted by grief and guilt. He asked to be transformed into a demon so that he could not ever be taken advantage of again in order to avoid more pain, and so that he might someday be defeated in the same manner that he had beaten Kairin, as a bizarre form of repentance. He blamed himself dearly for the slaughter of his students, and didn't approve of his own narrow-minded and reckless path to revenge, and in his twisted view, his death at the hands of a human stronger than him would balance the scales and set the universe right. But he has long abandoned his hopes of meeting someone capable of defeating him, so he lives his life aimlessly, completing jobs and defeating opponents, always looking to become stronger to avoid the possibility of defeat, even though he desires it. If you can't tell, Toguro is a paradox. As such, his philosophy in life is that all that matters is strength, and that in life you have two choices: to either die or get stronger. He begins taking jobs as hired muscle, but retains a strict moral code, maintaining a portion of his former self in some small way. In his purely human form, Toguro always simply reports to the highest bidder, and is very much against killing or harming anything if his job does not call for it. He has an extreme dislike for dishonorable people or cheaters, and is definitely not against killing these types. But in general, Toguro is a conflicted, tortured soul, constantly yearning for the one opponent that he'll be able to go all out against and lose to, yet at the same time hoping that he'll never lose. He feels and cares far more than his calm and detached exterior lets on, and he searches for 50 years in vain for the one to end his suffering. Despite all of the awful things that Toguro does throughout his life, and independent from all the people that he's killed, he has redeeming qualities, and leads a sad and sympathetic existence. This humanizes him, making him much more than a mindless, fighting brute, even if his actions at times were beyond forgiving. Our initial impression of Toguro is that he's basically a hired thug who harbors an extreme love for combat, but his deeper characterization is hinted at almost immediately. What's interesting is that I've seen others postulate that there was no sense of Toguro being anything other than a cold and mindless killer until the latter phase of the Dark Tournament. For instance, in Super Eyepatch Wolf's awesome video about villains, he states that the moment where Toguro asks Sakio for orange juice was the first moment in the series that humanized him. But I somewhat disagree with that notion. For me, a deeper and more complex aspect to Toguro was evident almost directly from his introduction. He's hired by a vile man named Terukane to extract Hiraseki stones from Yukina, the likes of which can only be produced by tears. The plan is naturally to physically and emotionally torture the poor girl until she cries and yields the valuable stones. After Yukina is traumatized by the death of some birds that she had befriended, Toguro tells her that she would make it a lot less hard on herself if she just gave up and accepted her fate instead of struggling against it. Now, why would Toguro say this? One could argue that he just wanted to make his job easier, but that doesn't exactly fit the profile of a man who has never been adverse to working hard. It just seems to me that he said this because he feels sympathy for Yukina, and doesn't want to cause her unnecessary pain. From this point on, it's established that Toguro has at least some sense of a moral code, and rather than waiting for a seemingly shallow villain to be revealed as a deeper character, I found myself looking for hints throughout the story that would expand upon this little bit of foreshadowing that Toguro had displayed here. There was always something in the back of my mind throughout the Dark Tournament that gave me the impression that there was some sort of humanity behind the sunglasses. Toguro's ideal of simply working for the highest bidder is reinforced when it's revealed that he's been working for Sakio to earn him Terukane's fortune by faking his own death at the hands of Yusuke. But through this task, Yusuke awakens something in Toguro, just the littlest inkling of an idea that this young man might, just might, be the one to put his soul to rest. This interest carries through the Dark Tournament, during which, apart from his battles, Toguro is mostly a passive observer of Yusuke, being invested in his power progression in the hopes that he'd prove to be worthy to fight at full strength. He decides that if this young man with so much potential is unable to beat him, then Sakio's plan of opening up the gate to Demon World would be a good way to test his strength as a plan B. Being clearly self-destructive, this point is where Toguro truly opens up as a character, and stemming from this, I found the fight between Toguro and Genkai, who should have stayed dead, I'm just saying, prior to the Team Yusuke vs. Team Toguro finals, to be one of the highlights of the series. It's the quintessential example of a battle with so much meaning behind the fist swings. This was an ideological duel more than a physical one, and let me explain why. As I said earlier, Toguro holds the claim that there are only two options in life, to die or to get stronger. Because of the fact that his vulnerability led to his students being killed, Toguro never wants to show weakness, or lose, or age, ever again, as an extreme psychological compensation. He grows to despise the fragility of life, and the inevitability of death.
I can't help but think our human lives are nothing but a cruel joke. Here long enough just to know what we want, and then it erodes.
Here, Toguro begins guarding himself, thinking that the less he cares, the less potential for pain he'll have, and this allows him to shift his life into one completely encapsulated by combat. He sort of parallels with Berserk's Guts, who believed throughout his early life that existence was nothing more than fighting, and that the only value in life could come from victory and survival. Where the two men contrast, though, is in how they feel about their emptiness. Guts acknowledges it and yearns to search for a greater meaning, whereas Toguro seeks atonement and solace in it, clinging on his skills in battle like a lifeboat, while ironically hoping that someone can come along to end his life and complete the cycle. Guts strives for something more meaningful, while Toguro strives to numb the pain. Genkai, on the other hand, sympathizes and relates to Toguro's suffering and pain, but finds value in being genuine. Her whole outlook is that there is no shame in showing weakness, and that only through growing from tough times can we develop as a person. Genkai believes that this is how we will all struggle and eventually find our place in the world, and that Toguro's insistence on invincibility is cowardly. We must all experience pain, and exposing oneself to pain is a sign of both humanity and strength. Although she has very little hope of properly defeating Toguro, Genkai wishes for Yusuke to win, to both prove his sad ideology wrong, and to put an end to her former lover's suffering. Toguro needed to win here, to feel as though Genkai was incorrect in saying that there was nothing wrong with weakness, and that all that he had sacrificed to get here was justified. But the fact that he was insecure at all about this in the first place insinuates that he was already filled with regret at his path, but was too far gone to change it. The notion that this battle was one that Toguro wanted to win for personal ideological reasons is solidified for me in seeing how he reacts to his older brother disrespecting Genkai. He doesn't want to hear someone who he respects and had such a close relationship with scorned. He wants to preserve Genkai's honor. To further emphasize this, after he kills her, he makes a point to Koenma to keep her body safe, predicting that Yusuke will revive her as a reward if he ends up winning. Toguro doesn't hate her or anything, but that earlier battle was something that he needed to win in order to prove to himself that all of this was worth it. And he papers up the cracks for now, but his next battle changes everything. To try and sum up the awesome battle between Yusuke and Toguro would be doing it a disservice, but I found the progression in the fight to be really interesting. As Toguro begins to steadily unleash more and more power, he simultaneously tried to push and prod Yusuke into increasing his motivation to fight, subconsciously letting the audience into his mindset just a little bit. It gets to the point where Toguro wants Yusuke to win so badly that he essentially stops thinking about how he can win and starts focusing on how he can get his adversary to reach his potential. And I think this fact right here answers the question regarding which side of Toguro is dominant. The two conflicting motivations that Toguro has, one being that he does not want to show weakness, and the other being that he wishes to be defeated, have dictated the way he lived his life. But in this moment, we can see that in Toguro's heart of hearts, he can accept defeat and the very human pain of weakness. And to further confirm that there is a simple, just man underneath all of the pain, suffering, and grief, the fact that Toguro faked killing Kuwabara and didn't actually kill him, to unleash Yusuke's power was a very telling indication. Although, to further drive home the contradiction of this man, the way he began killing audience members en masse accentuated the fact that the simple man underneath all of the suffering was far too gone for anything to be done. Toguro is delighted to finally be able to use 100% of his strength against Yusuke after the latter is struck by grief and seeing the supposed death of his friend. In a moment of striking poetry and surprising mutual respect, Yusuke finally defeats Toguro, seemingly putting him out of his misery, until we see what occurs in the afterlife. Yusuke defeating him somewhat ironically confirms to Toguro what Genkai had been saying all along, that it's okay to lose sometimes, it's okay to be mortal. But sadly, that didn't change Toguro's desire for insanity-ridden atonement. In the afterlife, he demands to be sent to hell, or limbo in the anime, to endure cycle after cycle of unbelievable pain, despite Koenma's insistence that Toguro doesn't deserve such a punishment. En route to the gates of hell, Genkai stops Toguro, saying that he need not endure this suffering as he has suffered enough in life. But with his mind inexplicably set, Toguro ignores this and asks that Genkai take care of Yusuke, making sure that he doesn't repeat Toguro's mistakes. After Genkai says that Yusuke is the closest thing she's ever had to a son, Toguro surprisingly says the same. He then passes on into an afterlife of brutality. What's saddest about Toguro to me is that he never believed that he would ever be able to atone for his failures, and his reaction to this incorrect assumption ironically turned him irredeemable. He has such a low opinion of himself that he believes the only way for his sins to even approach forgiveness is for him to die and then be tortured for eternity. There's a really tragic, self-loathing element to Toguro, and I believe that he wears sunglasses because he can't stand to see in a mirror and look himself in the eyes after all that he blames himself for. This once decent man had his life destroyed because of one singular event that brutally displayed his vulnerability, and since then, Toguro turned this into a motivation to never be vulnerable again. Invincibility, strength, victory, these were all essential for his goal. To get stronger to numb the agonizing pain, to atone in his own way. But contrasting this, in becoming something like the monster that destroyed his life, he wished to challenge someone who would be able to defeat him. He seeks a sort of poetic repetition of his early life. In killing Genkai and fake killing Kuwabara, he makes Yusuke feel pain incredibly similar to his own. He goads Yusuke to give in to his hatred and darkness, to block away his emotion, to become even stronger. And he does all of this in a desperate hope that someone could go through the suffering and the loss and the pain that he went through and still prove to be a good person at heart in the end. He hopes that this was not a universal case and that people are not doomed to darkness the moment that tragedy strikes. Yusuke wins against him in the only way that Toguro can comprehend, and he finally sees the light. This is why he feels such a bond with Yusuke at the end. Because he feels such a deep pride in the fact that he succeeded where Toguro didn't, and did not give in to madness and hate in his grief. Toguro is essentially a self-aware, tragic madman. In a life so filled with regret, he finds solace in knowing that there is good in the world, and that it is our character that forms who we are, not the events that happen to us. His exit was a quiet, sad moment that confirmed to me that Toguro had elevated Yu Yu Hakusho into an intellectually stimulating and morally thought-provoking series. As he walks on into limbo and the unnameable torture awaiting him, Toguro concludes his character arc and beautifully ties up the story of a simple, good-hearted man broken by grief and twisted by tragedy. It's not a happy ending, nor is it a conclusive one, but it's strangely appropriate. Whenever I talk about why I enjoyed villains in shows, I tend to run into a lot of people who believe in a weird sort of dichotomy that find issue with my stance on them. In my Hisoka, Phantom Troop, and Zoldyck Family videos, along with my videos on Makishima and Kefka, where I talk at length about why these characters are awesome, I've had people comment who feel the need to remind me that these people are cold killers and bad people. Of course, I would never endorse or try to justify murder or some of the acts that these people commit, but the stories that they're in do enough to obviously highlight why they're villains, whereas I'm concerned with the subtler question of why they're good villains. And to me, a good villain is one that makes you think. One that paradoxically rouses sympathy in you due to their inner motivations and backstory, in spite of how awful of people you think they are. The best villains in the medium aren't pure evil, but conflicted, pained, complex, and human characters. And that's what Toguro was. The reasons behind his actions don't justify his actions, and the good in him never overpowered the morally bad, but these little contradictions within him elevate him. Like I said before, I'm someone who firmly believes that it's not the events that happen to a person that define a person, but the way in which one responds to said events that shapes who they become. So it's not that the tragedy behind Toguro excuses the things that he did, but that it emphasizes that there is some good in him, despite how overwhelmed it is by the dark. And this stirs emotion in the audience. Whether it be pity for how he lived most of his entire life without true human connection, or sympathy for how his students died in the past, or sadness at the fact that a good man had been so transformed by grief, or a perplexed horror at how twisted he had become, Toguro is someone that resonates with and gets a reaction out of the audience for one reason or another. And that, along with how goddamn awesome the final fight of the Dark Tournament was, and how he impacted Yusuke and the outlook of the story as a whole, is what makes younger Toguro one of my favorite anime villains. I really hope that you enjoyed my first part of a look at Yu Yu Hakusho's antagonists, and I'd really love to hear some of your thoughts on Toguro. Stay tuned for part 2 sometime in the future, and once again, thank you so much for the continued support. All the best, and I'll see you guys next time.
I don't understand the man's way of thinking, sir. Why would he choose to become like the creature he most despised?
Well, that's the million-dollar question. Perhaps it was guilt for not protecting his students. Even though he'd avenged them, it wasn't enough. The only way to atone was to never be vulnerable again. Perhaps he wanted to become the monster he already felt himself to be. Perhaps he was just afraid of loving someone. Perhaps he was just afraid of growing old. Tagoro is a complex case. He's like an anthill. The deeper you dig, the more tunnels appear, and inside each is a creature ready to bite. Layer upon layer of bravado facades, contradicting desires and intensely wrought obsessions. But beneath it all, I suspect you would find just a normal man with a wounded heart and a broken dream.